So I'll try, sorry for being late in the last lecture. I will try to be a little bit faster than the previous one. But please interrupt me. If there are any kind of question, please stop me so we can ask. Okay, so this lecture is about one of the most popular and fundamental free energy method, which is called umbrella sampling, and we will see basic theory, what you have to do in your exercise from a workflow point of view, and what you have to be careful and be aware of. And then we will talk about steer molecular dynamics. So most of the theory, at least in general, has been introduced by Giovanni through the Jasinski and Crookes equations. We will look at this from a more practical point of view and with an example, hopefully. Okay, so let's skip this. Giovanni introduced the concept of dimensional reduction, and which relies on the fact that sometimes it's possible to describe a physical and chemical process in terms of smaller number of degrees of freedom of your system, and we call it S, we call it collective variable, usually. And the key quantity, if in this course representation, is the free energy as a function of this variable, which is defined in terms of a probability distribution of observing this value of the CV, and this is the relation that Giovanni showed you. It's not a scaling relation, it's just dumping together all those microscopic configuration that has a given value of the same value of the collective variable, each weighted by the Boltzmann factor. So this is the key quantity, when at least for thermodynamics, when you talk about a dimensional reduction of your system. So, one possibility, one idea of a lot of a wide class again of method to accelerate sampling is to do a bias sampling in which to the potential energy of your system you add an external term, static, which does not depend on time, is an external potential which depends just on the value of this collective variable. And we call this V. So we have a new ensemble. And in this new ensemble, the potential energy is U plus the external potential as a function of S. And in this bias ensemble, the free energy, again, is related to the probability distribution in this ensemble through the same relation. And if we write it here, we see exactly the same thing. But the weight is now the potential energy of the original system plus the bias potential. And you can play with this equation very easily, and then you find the relation between the two free energy. So the free energy in the new ensemble as a function of S is equal to the free energy in the old ensemble plus the bias potential. So this is the basic idea of a bias sampling in with a static potential in the collective variable space. Now, the idea is to carry on your simulation in this ensemble and then to recover recover properties in the original ensemble. So usually you have an observable which depends on the coordinates of the system. It might depend also on the momenta, but let's ignore this. It's just depending on the coordinate of the system. So you want to calculate the observable in the original ensemble U. And this is just an average weighted by the Boltzmann factor. So this is what you want. And the thing is that you are sampling an ensemble which is different. So you want to relate these two averages in the new ensemble, and you can, with some tricks, easy tricks, work out the relations. And this is a fundamental relation. When the bias is static, the relation between averages in the bias ensemble of this new observable, because if you see it is the old observable, multiplied, reweighted by these terms. And this is the average just on these terms. These two averages are carried out in the new ensemble. And this ratio is just the observable in the old ensemble. This is the basis. So the question is, how should we bias this the ensemble. So which is a good choice on the bias potential? So imagine that in the CV space, this is how it looks like. It's just a monodimensional collective variable. This is the free energy. This is how this the system looks like. How should we bias with this system with a potential to enhance the sampling on this coordinate? So one of the optimal candidates is something that gives you in the end a flat landscape in which you can just diffuse ver. So there's no more barriers, then it's easy for your system to just diffuse ver. And this is, if you keep in mind the relation in of the previous slide, one of the possible optimal bias potential is just the free energy change in sign. So this is perfect. We know how to optimally bias our system. We just put what we don't know, which is the free energy. So this is kind of a paradox. We don't know this free energy. This is what we are interested in. But it's also the optimal choice to enhance the sampling. So this is the idea of umbrella sampling, which is sometimes confused with what we will see in the next slide, which is something related to having harmonic restraint. This is not exactly what in the origin is the umbrella sampling. It's, as you can see, it's a very old paper, and it's just about modifying your potential energy with this static potential and obtain the original distribution through this reweighting. And it turns out, by simple consideration, that one of the optimal choice for the bias potential is minus the free energy. So if you have a way to estimate, to give also a rough estimate of your free energy of your system, then you can feed this as a bias potential, just changing in sign, sampling, and then you expect this situation or something similar, and then you go back to the original ensemble with your free energy. Perfect. Now, how can we apply in practice this relation? It's maybe not easy to have a global approximation of a free energy landscape, but we can think of having multiple local bias potential and somehow put together all these bias simulation. This is really what is called this is what goes under the name of weight histogram analysis methods, which is the idea is to do not one but multiple umbrella sampling simulation with an harmonic bias potential. So the bias is just parabola centered at a certain value of a CV space, and then you have multiple local bias simulation. You carry out this independently, and then you want to, you know each one how to unbias, because we have seen the relation. Then what you have to do is just combine this bias simulation to give your best estimate of the free energy. This is a weight histogram analysis method. And it's all about how to more optimally merge this bias umbrella sampling simulation. And so it's, the idea is pretty easy. So you have multiple bias simulation with L potential. What you have to do is carry out the simulation in this bias ensemble and collect an histogram. You bin your CV space and you collect the histogram. You just count how many times your system has been here, here, and there. And this is what you collect. And you normalize it. This is normalized. This is from your bias simulation. So what you do is writing this bias probability, this probability in bias ensemble, as a function of unbiased probability. This is what you don't know, this quantity, and you know that is because of the relation of the umbrella sampling is proportional to the bias which is present in this particular simulation and this particular bin. So this is a relation that holds for all your bias simulation for different bin of your CV space. And this, of course, depends just not on the simulation, but this depends just on the bin position. So this is a normalizing constant. We can see it like this because we want this to sum to one over all we want this to sum to one over all the possible bin, so we have a normalizing constant in front of this. And this needs to be determined. How? What I will show quickly is a derivation using the maximum likelihood principle, which I will introduce in the next slide. So basically, if given an histogram collecting the bias simulation, what is the probability of observing this histogram? And you can write this in terms of the free probability of that particular bin in that particular bias simulation, and this is just a combination of permutation of the inside the bin. So it doesn't need to go into too much into the detail. There are some assumptions, like the counts in each bin are independent, and we will see this is not always the case, but let's go through it. And then you have L histogram, because you have L bias simulation, so you want the probability in of observing this L dimensional histogram, and then you just multiply, assuming independencies of the bias simulation, you just multiply the probability of the previous slide. Good. We have a relation of the probability of observing in this particular.
A bit lost. What is this n, small n again?
Sorry, this is the number of counts in that particular histogram. So this is an histogram until m, and these are the binning of this histogram. So this is the count of entries in this particular bin, and this is the probability of adding visualization in your bias simulation. And this is proportional to the probability, to the bias probability in this bin of this simulation. So this is the assumption, so just putting inside the assumption that this probability is proportional to the unbiased probability through the bias as a normalizing constant. Okay, the thing is, all the WAM is a determination of these two parameters, the unbiased probability and this normalization constant. So how to find these numbers, and the explanation is a maximum likelihood principle, which is, I don't know if you all know about this or never heard about maximum likelihood. Yes? No? Okay. So in three words, you have some data, and you want to explain with this data with a statistical model in which you have some parameters that you don't know. And the maximum likelihood is a way to pick this parameter based on this rationale. So you want those parameters, they generate a probability distribution that has a maximum in the observed data. And this is exactly what we had before, what we had in the previous slide. We have the probability of observing the data through two unknown parameters. So we want to choose or find these parameters in order for the probability distribution of observing the data to be maximum. This is the idea underlying the maximum likelihood. And without going into the detail of the derivation, this principle leads to an expression for these two numbers that we have to define. One, two numbers, this is actually one per bin. And as you can see, is something that is a pair of equations that need to solve self-consistently by iteration, because here you have parameter f, and in f you have in f is something that you have to determine based on the unbiased probability. So you have to solve this by iteration, but I am not going too much into the detail. So this is the basic idea of a WAM. You collect L, biased statistics on small portion of your collective variable space in which you have put a restraining potential, a biasing potential, which is harmonic, and then you know how to unbias its simulation, but you want to put together all the simulation that together cover the entire phase space or collective variable space. So you need to place this umbrella properly because you want to connect all the statistics. Otherwise, you reconstruct the free energy in isolated part of your S space, and you cannot say anything about how to go from one place to the other. So you want to cover your entire space. And once you have done this, you have a way to reconstruct, to estimate the unbiased free energy through this procedure. So this is the weight histogram analysis method. Technicality, so one of the assumptions was the two assumptions that the bias histograms were independent, and then the data inside each histogram was independent. This is not always the case, because data points are correlated, and there are ways to account for this through the autocorrelation time, and I don't want to go into the details of this. So there is a way to treat the correlation between the points in each histogram. It's fair to assume that different simulations are independent. Okay, so I already told you the steps in the umbrella samples plus one procedure. You define the collective variable first, which seems just one line of on this screen, but is one of the most difficult things to do. Then you define the space of a CV that you want to cover when you will put the bias potential. It seems another two lines, but it means that you know a little bit something about your system. You know where the minima, the important region are, so you know something about your landscape because you are defining the region that you want to cover, and this might not be so easy. Then you have to choose two things: the distribution of umbrella, where to place this umbrella, and how strong is this harmonic potential. And there is a trade-off here. So what happens if your spring constant is too tight, too strong? You will your strain simulation will stay very close to the center of the umbrella, so you will collect the statistic around the point in which is center of the umbrella. But to cover a region of the CV space and guarantee overlap, because you want to connect all these pieces of free energy, you need to place a number of umbrellas. From the other side, if your strain is too weak, you are not actually sampling the region you're interested in. So it's very easy to understand when you're close to a transition state. So this is your landscape. This is free energy. So the problematic point are in this region of a transition state. So if you place a very, very, very weak potential here, remember that your system experienced both the underlying free energy and the restrained potential. So if this is really weak, basically the effective potential at the end of the day is just in going out far from the point that you want to sample. So you want also to have statistics in this problematic point. If the restraint is too weak, you just don't stay there. So this is the trade-off between, yes?
So it's fine to use the different.
That should be fine, yes. Yes. Unless they are constant during the wind of your collection, that should be fine. And of course, while you are close to the minimum, you basically it's already staying there without need to an umbrella. So there are different scales of intensity that you might need, so it makes sense. Okay, so this is what you have to do when you perform your simulation in each of the umbrellas. And how long the simulation should be. The idea is that your dimensional reduction is a good one, in the sense that you haven't missed something that is slow, a degrees of freedom that is slow. So all but S is equilibrating very fast. So when you are fixing a value of a collective variable, all the rest of the system, basically, in the time scale of your umbrella, is at equilibrium. So it can easily access all the micro configuration at the fixed value of a CV space. This is a measure of how good is your collective variable for this. So all the rest, all the things that are not restrained, must be able to equilibrate in the time scale of my umbrella. Otherwise, the estimate of the free energy in that particular umbrella might be wrong. Then you, okay, this is trivial, you calculate on your simulation, which are configuration, the value of a collective variable, and then you apply the code. You apply the one procedure. So you don't have, unless you want to, you don't have to write your own one code. There are two very popular code, one from Aaron Grossfield, and the one is the tool in Gromat, which is called G1. So this is the example we will play with in the afternoon, hopefully. It's the usual analog dipeptide, and I would like to play with the different parameters and also seeing what happens when I'm doing the umbrella on a fast degrees of freedom and forgetting the other degrees of freedom. What happened? How does it look like with free energy? Is this correct? Is this wrong? This is what we would like to play with. Okay, so very briefly, because I already told you everything, so you have to equilibrate the slow degrees of freedom. This is essential. It might be tricky, and you realize it easily if you repeat your simulation or umbrella starting from a different position in the microscopic position, which means that the variable, if you have a slow variable, it is another position, that you obtain a totally different estimate of the free energy. Probably you don't realize it with looking at a single profile, but if you repeat the simulation with a slightly different configuration, you might find something completely different. And this tells you, okay, some of my estimate of the free energy are wrong, because maybe I'm forgetting something. If this is the case, nothing prevents you to combine umbrella sampling with other techniques that we have seen in the previous lecture. So it's just a matter of how I'm carrying my bias simulation in each window. I can use whatever, I can combine my umbrella with other methods. Think of replica exchange, parallel tempering. Other methods can take care of the degrees of freedom that I'm missing, so that in the CV space, in the S coordinate, I can reconstruct the right free energy. So you can think of this kind of combination, and be careful, because the WAM sticks together different pieces of the free energy. So you might be wrong in one part, and probably when you stick things, you get things wrong almost everywhere from that point on. So it's a merging procedure, so you want to get it right everywhere. And you need some knowledge of the landscape, and this procedure is kind of problematic when you grow in the dimension of a CV. And usually 2 is already the maximum number of CV, which can be a limitation. Okay. I'm super late. I will go even faster. So now I would like to talk about another very popular method, which is Stier molecular dynamics. And it's based on the idea of dragging the system to a target value of your collective variable. And to do this, you have to act from the outside and do some work on the system, as Giovanni was telling you previously, to bring the system there where you want. And this is nice, because you accelerate somehow. You see things happening, but this is not enough. You want to also to say something quantitative of the system, which is the different free energy between initial and final states. And as Giovanni told you, when you do work on the system, then the relation between different free energy work that we've done is, you have to be careful in calculating equilibrium properties from non-equilibrium simulation in a correct way. So I will skip, some of the details. And so the idea is drag the system to a target value of the CD, of the CV space. You can do this in 2 ways: constant force applied to the system, or moving restraint with constant velocity, which is basically what is in the first part of the whiteboard. You change the position of an harmonic restraint with time, and the velocity is kept constant. This is probably the most popular way to do STIR-MD, I think. And so I will focus just on constant velocity pulling. And so it's very easy, the math here. You just add a time-dependent potential, which is an harmonic, and the center is moving a constant velocity with time. And since it's a non-equilibrium simulation with a time-dependent potential, there is a work from an external force, and we know how the difference in free energy is related to the to this work, because Giovanni already told you everything, and told you also how can we write an equation instead of equality, instead of inequality, and this is the Jarzynski equality. So if you pick the average of the exponential or minus the work, then you can connect to the difference in free energy of your system. There is some tricky things here. So this difference in free energies is between the state of your new system. So you have your old system, U, previous slide, and then you have your new system, U prime gamma, which depends on the moving potential. So Jarzynski equality says something about the difference in free energy of this system. What you're interested in is something else, which is the difference in PMF, or free energy, of a collective variable in your original system. So there is a map between these two free energy. And luckily, under certain condition, which we call stiff spring approximation, so if this parabola is very strong, these two quantities, the free energy in the ensemble U prime and the free energy in the original ensemble, are roughly the same. So this is just a technicality, which is not that technicality, it's something important. So you want this strain very strong, because what you recover from Jarzynski equality is a different free energy in the ensemble that you are interested in, because the position of your system is very close, stay close to the position, to the center of the restraint. This is the reason why. So we are happy. We have under this assumption a simple equation to relate the average of exponential of the work to a free energy difference. The problem, a lot of problems are technical and are related to evaluating this exponential average. And the problem is that the points that contribute most to this average are very unlikely trajectories. And this you can see it easily if you plot. This is the distribution of work, kind of Gaussian. And the quantity that you are interested in is the product of this exponential and the probability. And the probability of work. This is something that is shifted with respect to the work distribution. So, what does it mean? It means that the thing that contributes more to this, to what you are going to calculate, lie in this region of a distribution of work. So, a very unlikely trajectory contributes the most to the quantity that you have to calculate. And this is not good. And you can see it easily in assuming that this is Gaussian. This is still again a Gaussian distribution, but the center is shifted, and the shift depends on the sigma of your original distribution. So you want this not to be too much shift in order for being able to sample accurately those trajectory that determine are more determinant in the average. And there are ways to deal with this problem. And already Giovanni introduced you what is the cumulant expansion. When you have to calculate the logarithm of an average, you can expand this in cumulants. So you have an average of the quantity, no more of the exponential of the quantity. And this, of course, goes on and on and on. So all these cumulants are non-zero. There are two situations. Either there are an infinite number of non-zero cumulants, or just the first two are non-zero, and then all the others are zero. And this is if and only if the distribution of work is Gaussian. So if the distribution of work is Gaussian, all the cumulants but the first two are zero. So this relation, basically, truncated here, is exact. Okay, so in this approximation, when the distribution is Gaussian, you can use this relation. But of course, this is not always the case. I want to show you, if I have time, an example in why this cumulant expansion at second order might be convenient even when the work distribution is not that Gaussian. Because in case of finite sampling, so if you have an infinite number of trajectories, you are able to calculate your exponential averages perfectly. You don't need any approximation, so you don't need any cumulants. But this is not the case. You have a finite number, you have a finite sampling. And I would like to show you an example in which, when you have finite samplings, it might be more accurate to use an approximation, a truncation, because these terms, which are not averages of exponential, are a little bit easier to evaluate when you have a poor sample because of the shape of the distribution. This is W p W, and this is to the square root. This is the one that you should sample to calculate an exponential average. And these are the one that you need when you do a second order cumulant expansion. So if you have a finite sample, it might be more accurate to use an approximate formula, because in any case you are sampling regions that are good for the approximated formula. I don't know if this was clear. Sorry, I don't have a lot of time to explain this. I would like to show an example. Okay, I show this example and I'm done. So this is a helix coil transition of deca-alanine. So you just steer the system on the CV, which is the end-to-end distance. And I have different picture in the next slide. So we are pulling at constant velocities, and I will show you results for different speed and of dragging, and with different way of reconstruct the free energy. Jarzynski exponential average, cumulant expansion, first order, second order, and see how it goes with different value of the speed of steering. So the first is when I pull very, 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 very slow. So this is 0.1 angstrom per nanosecond, and I pull in two direction. So I first extend the helix, and then I contract the helix. And what the authors, I didn't do it, what the authors notice, that if you pull that slow, and 200 nanoseconds per direction, the process is reversible, and you take the work in one direction, and in the other direction, they are exactly identical. And in this situation, the difference in free energy is exactly, the average of the work is the difference in free energy. This is a reversible process, and it is incredibly slow. So this is the limit of very slow pulling. So I will skip all this part of the convolution of energy and free energy. Oh. And I want just to show what happened with the irreversible pulling. So here there are 100 trajectories. To calculate an ensemble, an average, the exponential average, the average is on the initial of the trajectories, which are initiated with respect to different points in the original ensemble. This already Giovanni told you. So you need a distribution of starting position according to the Hamiltonian at time zero. These are the ensemble on which you do the average. So these are two different speeds, and the PMF, free energy, calculated in four different ways. So this is the exponential average here and here. If you had an infinite number of pulling, you would do like this, and you would calculate through Jarzynski equality the free energy. Instead, you have less than infinite number of realization, and here is the first order expansion, which I put it here, is equivalent to say the process is reversible. If the process is not reversible here, because you are doing things at too high speed, and so the difference between the PMF and this estimate is a measure of this thing. So the faster is your pulling, the higher is the difference between the two points. Here instead is the second order cumulative expansion, which the point of this paper was to show that this was, because of the finite sampling, a better estimate. It's almost equivalent here, but it looks equivalent here. It's a little bit better, the difference between exponential average and second order cumulative expansion at faster pace of pulling. So here was the point. You cannot afford infinite pulling. It's better to use in this situation an approximate formula for which you can calculate with a limited number of realization something better. I don't know if it's sorry for being so fast, but I hope this afternoon we can play with an example. And I think we can stop it here, unless you have any questions. No question?
Yes.
Wait, sir.
If I understand correctly, so in all the cases, we see that like the minima in the free energy, PMF, as you said.
Yes.
It is unaffected. So, like the.
This is depend also how you align these profiles. In the sense that it's an effect because this is defined
right.
Modulo.
Yeah.
You mean the error in this region is lower than yes, that is true. But this the position is modulo an offset in the
right.
in the thing. So I don't know exactly where this has been aligned. Yes.
Can you give us a physical idea of what a collective variable is? Can we say that moving from reactant to product, can that be a collective variable? Or do we only look at conformational changes, like something that goes from alpha
to okay, this is this question requires a very long answer, in the sense that it will be basically the rest of the workshop will be on some part of the workshop will be on this. There are different things. So you can define as a collective variable any kind of a function of the coordinates. Okay. Then, if you calculate the free energy between two of these microstates, then if you do things properly in the sense that you equilibrate the other degrees of freedom, you will have a correct answer in the sense you will get the population of these two states. How you get from one state to the other is a totally different question. Your free energy profile will have two minima, if these are two minima in this CV space, and a transition state. Then transition states might have no dynamical meaning, in the sense if I sit my system on top of this barrier, if it's a real transition state dynamical, I have 1/2 probability of going to the reactant, 1/2 of the product. With a choice of a generic collective value as a function of a coordinate, you don't have this guarantee. You might initialize your system there and just get stuck there, because this dimensional reduction might not be a good one to describe the how the kinetics, how the transition between two states are happening. And this you will learn a lot about this in the rest of the. So if you are looking for something just to determine the difference in free energy and population between two states, you want something that can distinguish between these two states from a coarse point of view without specifying all the coordinates of your system. That is the kind of dimensional reduction that that is the only requirement for having meaningful description of the microstate. For dynamical and rates and all these kind of quantities, you need something more from your collective variable. This is an extremely important point, but I'm sure it will be discussed thoroughly in the next few days. Any other questions? Okay, I think it's time for food, right? Okay, thank you.